I think poetry sounds better in pre-lancination than in post-lancination. And when you are hungry, you know, poetry really sounds better. I don't know, this is my personal reaction to poetry. So anyway, some of us, yesterday I was also feeling drowsy after lunch. Maybe it's because I climbed a bit. So today we are going to launch this book. This book is called Himalayan Poem by Nishi Chawla. So Nishi has requested me to read the back cover before we launch the book. And this back cover is about the poem. It's a long poem. It has a lot of sections, as many as 7-8 sections, right? Each section is unique and complete by itself. And finally, each one is contributing to the whole book. It says, Nishi Chawla's long poem titled, A Himalayan Poem, is broken up into 8 sections. The long poem is an old personal response to the landscape of the mountains. Even as the poem explores its physical attributes, its rivers, its peaks, glaciers, its flora and fauna, its cultural traditions, both secular and spiritual, and its people. Section 1 is devoted to the origins of the Himalayas. Section 2 is about the rivers and lakes found in the Himalayas. Section 3 is devoted to the peaks and glaciers. Section 4 is about the trees and flowers found in the Himalayas. And section 5 is about the birds and animals. Section 6 is about environment degradation. And 7 is about temples and monasteries found in the Himalayas. And the final section is about what the mountains symbolize. So in brief, she has written, I think, this blurb introducing us to the core of the poem. So we are going to show you the book as a separate act of launching.
Thank you everyone for your time and effort in coming here to listen to me read from my 5th volume of poetry that's published early in 2017 and that's just been launched, A Himalayan Poem. My 110-page long poem is my own personal response to the cultural and physical landscape of the Himalayas. The Himalayas, of course, are not just grand and majestic and also somewhat intimidating. They also have a sense of sacredness about them. They move us and they speak to us as religion moves fervent believers. In the first section of my poem, I interweave the geological origins of the Himalayas within the ecological world. The carving of the Himalaya mountains, in spite of it being a geological blink of the eye, certainly involved the collision and shifting of the tectonic plates under the Earth's crust about 50 million years ago. The continental plates were crumbled as the Earth's crust shifted and moved and got folded and deformed by lateral compression. This process is called orogeny. The Himalayas are a young and dynamic mountain range, and its terrain is perpetually evolving. It is this unique and enigmatic nature of the Himalayas that has inspired the countless myths and legends that are associated with it. I read, "Yet being tall is being splendid, your room large, your largesse. Rise high and bold, covered in gleaming gold and green, rock brown, mighty and majestic, standing tall, you are the Himalayas, rock strong, a blanket of silvered mist covers your summits, your rocky life between." I'm establishing a dialogic sort of say, relationship with the Himalayas, addressing them as you. Himalaya proved you, his snow abode, where with his wife Minavati, he gave birth to the lovely Ganga and to the ever nurturing Parvati. Two daughters, two forms of women. 1500 miles of baby worship, a vast kingdom of mesmerizing meditation. Fate deciding karma, an experiential reality mixed with yam, share a portion of the divine, rituals of pure bhakti. Then undulate with ease, wave like rhythms, dance like the burning thunders of a jealous god come alive. Tower over the sandpour or gorge, drop down in sheer delight, falling down, down until you shiver, garnished in multi-costume finery, render draw, changing with the dark promise of the purest. Between the tall spear piercing the sky and the sheer drop down into the river, rests a vastness. Human imagination floats in the crevices of myths guarding them. If a journey, if a music can be created out of a collision, pulsing and surging between two tectonic plates, crush and break into a 1500 mile long mountain arc, decline its head, a section of the earth, becomes estranged, lumbers, lumpishly contorted and deformed, as if its throat was cold by the lateral compression. Orogeny is like a dance, the jewel of the youngest range, kindling new love into triangular stars, uplifted, metamorphosed, sedimented, drop-like, an ocean gathers around it, that is the Dead Sea, declines its head, Tethys gets buried, lost in the soft waters, the volcanoes fringing like antiques that are thrust vaulted. The art of composing a continental thrust, middle passages covered, subduct into an oceanic trench, designed to tighten around the body of the mantle, then rise. The blade pushes under the plateau, like a whisper rising to a scream, like a convergence, a visionary company, a seismic encroachment to fling. So you will rise higher, pulse by pulse, the ingenious of thrusts, keeping, growling in geological activity, nor barren, neither abated. Move upward. You have witnessed ice sheets compressed with pure rage, barely spread along your northern edges, crooked neighbor of my dreams, my dread. A vast delight of waters, a vast line of crystal waters, at the summit of mountains, their flashing eyes diamond like, their holy hair secluded like the weight of the gods. Far, far away, the Annapurna smile, as if the creator rivaled the rigid god, as if the pilgrim souls chanting annually make a blood void of the moon. They bring rice and flower offerings, their leaf patterns pulled tight as they flood upwards to Shiva's waters, their Hindu souls flicker, then divinely buoyant, brightening. The Himalayas have traditionally been associated with a state of heightened consciousness. The next few sections of my poem explore its physical attributes, its lakes and rivers, its glaciers and peaks, its flora and its fauna, and its people. I am reading excerpts or segments of the poem. Like strips of you, the majesty of the Himalayas, like a child from your womb, your rivers and lakes, like multi-lettered, many meaning, one-syllabled word, demand reverence, a space filled with your own being. The five sisters make a wish for keen defection, Vidasa, Askini, Iravati, Vipasha, and Jagatu flow through ancient channels, changing names. In this, Ramapurna, Ganga, Yamuna, and Spiti float by you, all Cylon bending, making space through your steep arm, blowing a whistle of watery blue in your stillness. Fill your heart with your waters as your power expands, enriched in harmony. Wilting in the arms of your glacial fields, mid Himalayan beauty sprung in the throes of boulders, massed forms of twisted memories, breathless, point to point, shattered riverbed. Pressing through river gorge of fire, creeping closer, rapid then roll into one another's arms, the process of a deep glare, walk then range through a spasmodic gate. Looking down, you form a quick parabola, entering against massive gorges, against the force of water, turn around, then move westward. A circle swoop, a slow whirl unfurled. Push, push, the lion's mouth is a mothering source. A twitch, Mount Kailash turns upon itself. Such a waterloo, sacred mountain, sacred mother of rivers, sacred form, propped on, lofty power, strength, trembling hand. The scattered chapter awakens, the roar of the Bhagirathi flows with scalding anjuns. A subglacial meltwater cave adorns, the river's heart lies where Gangotri's soul ejected, in head streams that unite, where the waters of Alaknanda and Bhagirathi touch, where rain and pain collide, their Ganga emerges, cutting, riddling your Himalayan sights from your cradle. Come into me, come unto me, this was Mount Everest, Sagarmath, as the neighboring stream strums, the upward path is one kind of goodbye. Tibetan Chomolungma is Earth's highest mountain. The sweet spirits of your mountains repeat, come unto me, the voice of the gods unfold. In Mount Everest, 29,000 feet high, shining the holy glimmer in Mahalangopima. Mount Everest stands with graceful intellection, deep beneath its mind, cut by faults and fractures, silence standing there, capture its glances, supreme. Clouds and storms pass you by. So what if your name has an English sense of stealing? Remember Mount Everest? A wayfaring traveler outsings, crumbling ice chunks that dislodge down labyrinthine ways. No steep cracks down the throat of Mount Everest. The north face turns the blood cold, Alpine style, the creased map of sullen bridges. No dwelling place in death zones. Rocks that contain untraced faults. Rocks that sediment the hidden hymns of time. Rocks that metamorphose forms of lingering notes. Only a moss grows, like a toothy-horned grimace injected. Those narrow walls of high-speed winds. A loud, south-splitting bassoon, fast and freezing jet stream, not even furtive pity, injected into the stratosphere, in a long white gown, confused, mounted and dressed in snow, blizzards that spew an unremembered time, and avalanches that could freeze death in its path, the turbid ardor of its rumbling, a thick blast of rock, ice and wind sliding, gliding, then shudder through its own massed head. Like white arms, bracelet and enduring, nature's girdled mountain massive, to view your living frame, strangely glorious heights, and heaps of divine ice beat your white wings, glacier, glacier everywhere, the lofty Zemo glacier in the northeast, proud Talon Glacier casts southeast glances. Yalun Glacier spreads southwestward. Kanchen propelled northwest. another set of massive Nanda Devi, as it feeds for museum pieces, as if Uttarakhand ripens the earth, bursting glory, a glacial basin, an icy ring of peaks, as in a bucket full of snow, drip by drip, Nanda Devi, hardened by its own snow, a flight of uncarpeted angled steps through a mist, hurriedly wave of mist. There is a web of ecological, so to say, cause and effect among the mountain species that is too complicated for us human beings to untangle. The Himalayan herds, ranges are an ideal habitat for a rich and unique species of flora and fauna. The varying life zones within the Himalayan ranges support an exciting range of fauna. Encroachment on the forest cover by the human population has of course forced many threatened species into the protected zones where the natural habitat is still preserved. This will naturally segue into the sixth section of my poem on the environmental forces that threaten the Himalayas, the biodiversity and human livelihoods of the region. But for now, I read segments from sections 4 and 5. Will the snowfall sink in gold to the dandelions and the mountain sorrel? The soil beneath that sustains and break into the trailing streams and lakes, through the whirlwind gorges that tumble down, the densely tufted rhododendrons that sparkle in the sun, pay themselves off as ecosystem engineers, acidify the mountain soil, their wounded impulses live in, else benefit themselves, like the gust swelling, threatened, corpse-like, unseeded, amid the western alpine shrubland, amid the rumbling, grumbling voices, rhododendrons fuse with the voice of summer, the gold on a long, wet Himalayan leash. Let me just read segments from section six until you read. The Himalayas are, of course, under threat. Deforestation is laying vast stretches of barren. Several rare and endemic species are threatened with extinction. And droughts and floods, of course, we all know, are a recurrent phenomenon. Although astoundingly rich in natural wealth, the Himalayas have lost almost 70% of its natural habitat, and its flora and fauna are in grave danger, threatened by both anthropogenic impacts as well as climate change. The human and ecological displacement, of course, flash floods, denudation, other biodiversity hotspots, climate change, of course, that has also contributed to the kind of increasing or accelerated glacial retreat observed in the Himalayas. But the view of the ecological displacement is one thing. To tease out a poem from it is another matter altogether. Let me read one or two sections from Deluging, and then we'll go to the last segment of the poem. Deluging, root rot is a real offense, wasted. Human life supports it as much as pathogens induced, inducted, accurately into the grand scheme of its old soil, snapped, conditions that acted corrode, coffin them, just as the human soul becomes compressed, shrewd as fungal pathogen, couch, piteous, eat, no pause, then eat. When conifers become susceptible, they kneel and bark, broken, limited by litter limb, the caustic stress effects shake these mountains, limbering, creeping, bend, move, break, austere trunks crack, old and mature trees molding, enclosed, disagree with each other, then end, hunch, send apocalyptic screams through their bellies. The Himalayas are linked, in my mind, to an inner disposition of the soul. It represents much more than an external landscape. The Himalayas are a reality that transcends reality. Its silence is a vision, its beauty a revelation, its enduring quality an eternal symbol. Let me read from the last segment, I think I need to voices of our primitive consciousness are heard in the mountains? What forms of self-reflection and observation are precipitated by the intimidating presence of these lofty mountains? What natural metaphor, what forms of sacraments, so to say, undergo a transformation as we kind of witness the mountains? Why are the Himalayas associated with moksha and detachment and renunciation, a tendency to use physical symbolism as a set of notations, seeking within it, searching within it, a direct and adequate expression, so to say, of spiritual conceptions? Your tall feet see how your people become a part of you, your fingers and theirs, a seamless soul, smooth growth of human gestures, your bones and theirs, a narrative of Indian cultures, proud shade, a part of you, a part of your silver deodar needs, simple prayers carved on monastery stones, your shadow fanned across curled lips of bells. As women carry their heavy loads, their faces disappear into your being, your masked conical head, simple mountain cultures dabbling out of simple second syllables, happy as the wind blowing through your spaces, insisting on a simple way of life. Like the glittering lights on your tumultuous back, twilight penetrating, clinking, your killer peaks gyrate under the burden of those voices. Layers of modernity hide the truth, their porous selves smothered, like a heavy load of pines carried on their back, their truths reshaped into spanking new boots. And just the last few stanzas. Prophesize, sacrifice, foreshadow, your kind of prophecies carry an atmosphere of collaborative possibilities. Like a new path of dreaming, gaining unknowns, your heights a mirage, like sedately blossoming powers, page turning back, eternity unguarded. Like eternity unguarded, you have worlds out there, sprout innumerable seeds. The bare spaces between your mountainous dreams imply an unclipped sacrality. Follow it always with your intent to look, eyes that dare, your tumbling rocks cannot hold. Your star-struck gaze is smeared with your milky white nibbles, unslept with snow-covered peaks. What nakedness stares down? Is there an afterglow? Like separate lives you would make us wince. So much dignity, we too would rise, or should. Mountains of intention, what elaborate towers would you leave with the gesture of a dare, brilliant force of intention, or is it invention? The fluidity of a golden eagle, what soaring heights would you move us toward, sage, or the virtue of what symbol?
As I launched the book, so I think that I have a few words in it from my side and good form. Poems for the readers of the book. So this is a long poem. A long poem running into, it's more than 100 pages, not a matter of joke. It's more than 100 pages, and as you have not seen the book, you know that the kind of skill that one needs to write a long poem, and you have a stanza pattern. Each stanza is four-line stanza, and either it's regular stanza pattern or irregular, but at the same time you have the, she has maintained this stanza pattern throughout the book, 109 pages, not a matter of joke. Just imagine the kind of skill one needs to work on such a long poem on the Himalayas. I took 40 years to publish 31 books. I have never mentioned the word Himalaya in any of my poems, and she has written a 100-page poem on Himalayas. Really, hats off to you. So this is really great, and I think Nishi Chawla, she said, when I was the editor of the literature, she used to send in poems from Washington, D.C. and also from elsewhere. And those poems are different. poems I publish in any literature. Those are different poems, but this time, she, it can be called, you know, the kind of movement that we had in Spanish world. It's a kind of ecological poem. It can be called, briefly, eco-poem. And this eco-poem is becoming more and more significant all over the world. It's not only for, I mean, not only in the Indian context, in the context of Himalayas, but also, you know, in the context of the world, climate, and everything. So in a way, I find this is not just a poem. A poem which is layered with a lot of mistakes. So it is a kind of mission in the form of a poem. An absolutely, you know, skilled poem. It's again and again, you wonder when you read the book, you find that how is it possible for a young writer, young or whatever it is. And all poets are young poets. And I believe that it's really difficult to work on such a long poem. And it just reminds me of one long poem that was in India, written by a Spanish young poet. I met him at IWB last year, International Writing Program in the University of Iowa in the US. I met him, and he had a long poem running into 100 pages on India, not on the Himalayas, on India, but it was really a different kind of poem. But here, I find this is really brilliant in the sense that this is a poem which is giving us a final signal, the last call for us. Please be careful about the environment that we are living in. Thank you very much. Thank you.